not had anything, shit to have given, he followed. Immediately, he did not allow the mind to console. So many people are there, so what can we do? Because he is also needing the food, you know. But instantaneously, cheerfully, and he was really mad, mad of Ram. He walked, then walked. Unconsciously, he directed his step to the fort and wandered from one street to another. At a certain turning on the footpath, the grief-stricken man of middle age saluted Ramdas and offered him a pipe. Returning the salute, he said he would not accept money, but would take fruits. At hand, there was another mother selling plantains. The friend brought one plantain for the pipe, handed it to Ramdas. Now he made Ramdas sit on the path and narrated his story, the person who gave the pipe. He said he had only one son, who was a veritable jewel. He was so intelligent, so mild, so good in character, so promising, so affectionate and loving, and also so handsome in features, such a model of perfection. And this one was carried away by plague about a month ago. Ever since this heavy loss, he had been stricken mad over the sad blow. He therefore begged Ramdas to find a way for him to bear this calamity. Ramdas then replied, "Brother, to sorrow over the loss of your son is to hug delusion. To be free from this sorrow means to know the reality. There is only one way to wake up to this reality, and that is to meditate upon God." "How can I do it? I cannot control the mind," put the friend. "Well, now begin here to repeat the mantra, which Ramdas is bidden by Ram to give you, and see the immediate effect." We remember the same simile, you know, before we prepare the pickle, we put lime or mango in the soap, hot water. Then it gets absorbed. Similarly, God remembrance, in God remembrance, the sense of individuality has been put. And the sense of individuality is now fully percolated with God remembrance only, you know. So even when there was a vyavahari dealing like giving mantra, he did not own that. It was Ram, bidden by Ram, you know. Ramdas, a mantra which Ramdas is bidden by Ram to give you. And another thing, this has happened in many, many, many occasions, yeah. It happens. God makes us to pass through such severe stress. When we hold somebody dear to us, then he suddenly passes away. And at that time, in order that we really make use of this God remembrance, he makes us to pass through the severe stress. That's what we have seen here. This man, why should he come across his papa then? Unless papa gets up from the place and walks alone, he will not meet, you know. Just imagine. God arranges all things in his own way, you know. This we should remember, you know, at every time. We may stop with the sacrifice. There is one more hidden motive behind it when Ram made him to get up and walk. Because this man has to be met, you know. He has to meet this man and give him some succor, support. Well, now begin here. Saying this, he gave him the upadesha of Ram mantra, made him repeat it then and there for about 15 minutes without stopping. Then he rose and saluting Ramdas said he had secured the right key to unlock the gates of peace. He further admitted that since repeating the mantra, he had been experiencing calmness and he would not give up repeating the way. Then he left the place. Ramdas continued his mad walk. Now he passed through the broad road adjoining the Post Trust building and docks. He went on and on, now going into the maze of streets and lanes, then passing over bridges and railway crossings. At last he found himself about 3 p.m. in front of a building which was familiar to him. Looking up, he discovered the signboard of Brother Tampish Rao, portrait painter by profession. Ram prompted him to get up the staircase, and in a few minutes he was in front of the room occupied by the artist brother. He was welcomed by the brother most heartily. With this brother he remained for 4 days. The members of his household were also very kind to him. I think it was here that the Chandrasekhar Rao met him.
I can see the person on my song.
During his stay here, Ramdas was utilizing the morning for visiting the various temples of Bombay and the sadhus residing near the temples. He spent one night on the footsteps of the large tank of Arkeshwar temple.
There.
So Bhuleshwar is different.
Bhuleshwar is different than
this. Why is that? We have no idea. Keeping awake almost the whole night in Tamil. So we requested once when during our Bombay trip to requested our Pinakin Bhai to take us there. And we were in the tank, footsteps of the tank. And then we were remembering the lines and by the
end of Pinakin Bhai.
Footsteps of the large tank of the Varkeshwar temple. Keeping awake almost the whole night in Ramgarh. By Ram's command, then he proposed to start. The kind brother Ramkrishna escorted him as far as the railway station and getting him a ticket for Nasik, saw him sit in the night train. Ramkrishna's anxiety for his comfort was so great that he pressed him to take a small packet containing plantains, oranges, and some sweets. The train started. Ram now got Ramdas in the company of another friend who was sitting beside him on the same bench. He travelled with Ramdas as far as 2 stations this side of Nasik. All the way he was talking of nothing else but Ram. Now and again he would sing about Ram composing songs extempore. In fact, he was more mad of Ram than Ramdas himself. Another point. So Ram was showing him, not only that I have prompted you, but I have prompted him. So many others also. Here Ram was teaching Ramdas how to become really mad at him. It was a perfect delight to enjoy his talk and songs of Ram. It was all Ram's preordained plan, and Ram is always kind. Before alighting, this friend requested another passenger who was close to him, who too was bound to Nasik, to guide and take care of Ram. Something like, you know, the baton. In due time, Nasik was reached. The new friend guided him out of the station. Here, finding a motor tram waiting, the friend got into it, beckoning to him, and Ramdas followed suit. Soon, the tram was full of passengers and the bell sounding it started. The tram conductor, after clipping tickets for other passengers, came to Ramdas and demanded fee for the ticket. Ramdas had of course no money, and so nothing to say in reply. While a number of passengers sitting near him, in almost one voice told the conductor not to bother the sadhu, as he was not supposed to possess money, and that he should be allowed to sit in the car. Of course, conductor yielded to their appeal on behalf of Ramdas. After 3 miles were passed, when a ticket inspector got in, he was an elderly man with whiskers. Coming to Ramdas, he asked for ticket. But Ramdas having no ticket, the inspector began to fret and worry over it, saying that the sadhu could not be allowed to travel free. When he was thus complaining, the same friends who had pleaded for Ramdas with the conductor again spoke for him, but could produce no impression on the inspector. So the only course open for Ramdas was to get down. Accordingly, standing up, he requested the inspector to stop the car so that he might alight. Here again, Ram's power prevailed. The attitude of the inspector now suddenly changed. He told him not to trouble himself and that he might continue the journey in the train. Ram's stress are at all times coming unawares. One should always be, this is the message, the final message. One should always be prepared for them and face all vicissitudes calmly and in complete resignation to His will. I think you have printed that KPT, huh? One should always be prepared to, for them, one should always be prepared for them, for what? For such ups and downs. And face all vicissitudes calmly, in complete resignation to His will. Then there is no sorrow, no disappointment, no fear of any kind. So that is the final message from this Bombay trip. One should always be prepared for them, because Ram's tests are at all times coming unawares. How is He going to test? With what He is going to test? Where He is going to test? No idea, no? In quest of God, sends this message. So long as you manage at your own level, individual level, it's all right, you need not read this. The moment you feel there is God's elements of God in all that I think, in all that I talk, in all that I do, and this, you must keep it in mind. At any time, from any quarter, the test can come. Ram's tests are at all times coming unawares. One should always be prepared for them and face all vicissitudes calmly and in complete resignation to His will. Then there is no sorrow, no disappointment, no fear of any kind. Panchavati was reached. Ramdas saw the beautiful river Godavari, on the banks of which there are a number of kshetras for feeding sadhus, brahmins and poor pilgrims. To one of these he directed his steps. On the veranda of a kshetra he found a number of vairagis, mendicant mothers, children. Here he, as prompted by Ram, opened the parcel of fruits given to him by Brother Ramkrishna Rao. He has not opened it then. Emptied the cloth in which they were tied by distributing them all among the small children at that place. This relieved him of a pretty heavy burden. Ram's order is always not to worry about food and clothing. Then Ramdas, going up to the holy river, washed his clothes after a bath, sat down on the bank of on the meditation of Ram. There are a number of rocks in between the river. Time passed. It was past midday. And when he arose, proceeded towards the Dharamshala and found on entering a number of sadhus and others coming out of the front door to wash their hands after dinner. Ramdas quietly sat outside all the time, busy with the repetition of Ram's name. Now a rough looking man approached him and sitting beside him asked Ramdas if he had his meal, to which he of course replied in the negative. Well, come on, I shall take you to a place where you can get a meal, he said. And then taking Ramdas by the hand, he conducted him a short distance away on the same road and entered a high building where he made inquiry if it was possible to give food to his sadhu. The friend who was asked this question on the veranda of the house went in to ascertain the matter. Meanwhile, the guide who took Ramdas here said, look here, Maharaj, you need have no anxiety about food. I shall see that you get a meal without fail, even if it is not available here. Papa says, when Ram Bhajan is on the lips of Ramdas, he is always far from such anxiety. Later, meals were offered at this kshetra. Ram takes care at every step. His concern for his devotee is 1,000 times more keen and lively than that of the mother of her newborn baby. Here we find the meaning of the trust, you know. not even not 1% doubt. Ram's concern for his devotees is 1,000 times more keen and lively than that of the mother of her newborn baby. How will we know? Only when we trust him. Now suppose we say, we will not. We have been arrogating that we are doing everything, you know. So he will not come. He said, okay, you arrange. We find out all the pros and cons. What he has given with the intellect. And we will try to plan and do that. So we cannot straight away apply this in our life. We have to condition our life. We have to prepare our life. Now Ram handed Ramdas into the hands of a retired merchant staying in Dharamshala, who became very much attached to him. At midnight, without his knowledge, his kind friend would cover Ramdas with a blanket, since he would not accept a kumbhal when offered. The cold on the banks of the Godavari at this time was extreme. At the pressure of this merchant friend, Ramdas remained with him for 2 days. During the second night, the friend questioned him if he had cultivated powers of inducing dreams. Ramdas replied that he was quite ignorant of that sadhana and he only knew how to utter the name of Ram. You can do it if only you wish, Guruji. Just for instance, desire intensely to know from Ram the winning numbers of the next derby season. And the number will be made known to you in a dream. Derby, I don't know now whether people will remember. On those days it was there. Arkata. It is something like our tickets for Udagam, one crore, you know.
Lottery
tickets. So Papa says, Ramdas requires none and nothing else but Ram. You see, the amount that might be won is not for selfish purpose, but for feeding sadhus, suggests the friend. Papa says, Ram sees the feeding of the sadhus. Returned Ramdas. The friend then became silent. This was again a test of Ram to find out if Ramdas could be tempted to wish for that. So we are shared again, you know, it comes up in our mind. When Varda Ashram was to be set up, Gandhiji asked Vinobaji to frame the rules. So one of the rules was, Varda Ashram will not accept any love offering. There was some land attached to the ashram. So those inmates, not only that they have to take 11 vradas, in that vradas, Harirashrama is there. They have to work in the field, produce the agricultural produce, and then with that they should continue. So it was decided not. This is the condition of Varda. It looked very, very, very pitiable. Even when we are sorry. What to do now? So when Gopinath Nayak, no? He narrated this. He was the president of Varda Ashram for 17 years. Gopinath Nayak came here and during one satsang he revealed this. So when Dr. Manmohan Singh was the Prime Minister, when he went to Varda, he saw the pitiable condition. He went back. From Prime Minister's fund, you know, he wrote a check for 5 crores, sumoto, without asking anything. When the check was received, the then president became upset. What to do now? So he convened a meeting of all the old president, Gandhi and everybody. And there was a big meeting. Then he said the Prime Minister had sent a check. What are we to do now? Gopinath Nayak said, everybody, you know, it's all right. Somebody probably would have said yes, but majority or 90% of them stood with Vinobaji's injunction. He said, no, we will not accept. Because if we accept, then we will have to subject ourselves to audit. That means how the money was spent. Somebody will ask tomorrow, it's the public money. So that means we must have an accountant. We must have a bank account. And then we will have cash deposit. We will distrust people. So many. What is not suiting to an ashram life, we will be forced to. So, with all gratitude, we will return the check, and the check will return. So that is it. Probably, you know, Papa also, when he drafted the custody, he did not make any provision for carpet for the ashram. And nothing is to be mobilized, you know. Specific. Accept voluntary donations. So God sends it through unasked. When you mobilize, you arrogate, you know, you are running the show. Whatever is needed at that time, God provides. Yes, God, you don't wait for providing, you don't timing for providing. So that you must have that faith, that trust, not faithful. Have complete trust in Him. So here we find, in 1923, Papa is expressing this, what we are now talking. God sees to the feeding of the sadhu. The friend then became silent. This was again a test of Ram to find out if Ramdas could be tempted to wish for them. Even today, the legacy, Papa is empowering others to keep it up. We won't say that we have developed that trust, but anyway, He provides. We are all praying only. In spite of your providing, why are you making us to doubt that we don't have trust in you? 100% trust is whether we have. It's a question which we are yet to get an answer from within. But still, we know that He provides. He has been providing. All these 89 years, this has been the basis of this ashram. So it's a proven, it is not something, you know, theory. What He uttered on 1923, it is still there. Another incident was this. In Dharamshala, there was a sick girl ailing from fever for about 4 months. Ramdas was asked by the mother of the girl to pray to Ram for her welfare. Accordingly, going up to her bed, finding her in high fever, he appealed to Ram to bless her with health. Ram's ways are always inscrutable. The girl mother seemed to have improved for about 2 days. But again, tell you, Ram alone knows the why and therefore. Next day at noon, Ramdas walked about 3 miles to reach a place called Tapovan. This is said to have been at the spot. In this incident also we find, you know, we put ourselves, you know. Many a times we have prayed and then it has been fulfilled. Here, it seems to be fulfilled, but not. But his faith was unshaken. Huh? That means even the prayer is not attributed to him, to that individual. He made him to pray, that's all. So the trust in him is not dependent upon anything that happens. Unqualified surrender, they say, you know. Unshakable. Ram alone knows the why and wherefore, no? He is defining what is trust. Next day at noon, Ramdas walked about 3 miles, reached a place called Tapovan. This is said to have been the spot where Lakshmana, the brother of Sri Ramchandra, cut the nose of the she monster Shurpanaka. Tapovan is a charming place, Here the clear water of the Godavari is flowing at the foot of low hills. To sit on one of these hills is to view a most attractive sea all around. Here on a large rock are cut out a number of rectangular caves side by side. About 10 feet from the bottom of the rock at which the water of the river is gushing along, Ramdas fixed up on a cave for a nice bhajan, and accordingly after a bath in the river climbed up, occupied it. The night was intensely cold, so he had not had a wink of sleep. He sat up the whole night repeating the sacred name of Ram. In Tapovan he had occasion to meet several sadhus. Next morning he returned to Panchavati, remained here for a day. Early in the morning, Ramdas started for Trimbakeshwar. 16 miles from Panchavati. He reached the place about 3 in the afternoon. First, the temple of Trimbakeshwar was visited. This place reminded him of Kedarnath and Badrinath. The plateau on which the town and the temple were built is surrounded by 3 sides with high mountains. He scaled these mountains one after the other. First to ascend was the small hill of Ambaji, next to the hill of Gangadwar, and then the still higher Brahmagiri. Climbing of Brahmagiri was a memorable one. Ramdas went up alone with Ram's name on his lips. Ascending the top of the hill, he got down the slope. On the other side, he came upon a small tank and a mandir of Shankar in which there was a sadhu. Ramdas was received by the sadhu very hospitably. He narrated the story of Gautama's tapasya on those hills in ancient times. The sadhu lives here alone in the company of a number of monkeys that ran about on the roof of the temple. After sharing with Ramdas his frugal fare, the sadhu pointed to him a thin footpath on the hill which he said would lead him to a place called Jatashankar. Accordingly, Ramdas started, accompanied also by a Brahmin pilgrim. But the Brahmin was with him only for a short distance, for when they had to walk amongst brambles, the high-grown grass and reeds, they missed each other. Both having lost their way, Ramdas now found a long line of steps cut into the bosom of the hills. Here he climbed down, and finding below a small opening, crept out of it on the other side, found himself on another hill. The way in which he has explained, you know, as if, you know, he has taken us literally through the footpath. Here he climbed down and finding below a small opening, crept out of it on the other side, found himself on another hill. Again, walking some distance, he came upon another similar passage. Going down here, he came upon the other side of the different hill. Here again, he proceeded further still. Now through thorny shrubs and thick growth of reeds, at last he came to the end of the summit. Here appeared on the extreme edge of the slope, something like a beaten track. Now Ramdas was standing on the brow of a tremendous precipice. The bottom of the hill could be seen from this place, straight down, vertically, many hundreds of feet below. Any attempt to walk upon the slope was very dangerous. But a strange fascination seemed to have seized Ramdas. He crept slowly upon the slope. His hold was thin, dried up grass that grew on the hill. Both his hands were engaged in this task. He was now on the slope. It was a condition which every moment had to be counted. But he was careless and fearless. Suddenly the dried grass in his left hand gave way. His left foot slipped. Ramdas was even now calm and unperturbed, his lips uttering Ram's name aloud. It was rather a very severe test on Ram's powers. Oh, he tested Ramdas. It was rather a very severe test on Ram's powers of protection. But nothing is impossible for the all-powerful Ram. Ramdas's other hand was then grasping a stone, which was also a little shaky. By a concentration of all strength at this point, he recovered his balance, drew up the leg that had slipped. This became all possible by the aid of Ram alone. It was Ram alone who pulled him up. A few minutes later, he was again on the same path that led him to the same. While returning, he came across a small tank full of pure spring water. Here he met again the Brahmin pilgrim, whom he had missed. Jatashankar could not be found. So both retraced their steps to the mandir, and finding the way downhill, the burning, reached Tirupati. That night, Ramdas could not help thinking again and again the wonderful manner in which Ram saved him while he was about to fall down the precipice. That same evening, he mounted up a small hillock and spent some time in the ashram of a Maratha saint. During his stay in Dharamshala, he had also the unique privilege of having the darshan of an old learned sannyasi permanently residing in the Dharamshala. In the course of his talk with Ramdas, the venerable saint condemned, in no uncertain terms, the use of silk by Brahmins as a sacred cloth. His contention was that cotton cloth is the best suited and of the purest material since it is made from a plant flower, whereas silk is produced by destroying thousands of innocent silkworms. So he considered that instead of silk cloth being holy, it is the most sinful article for wear and must be totally eschewed. Further, he said that crores of rupees worth of silk was every year being imported from China, Japan and other countries, which meant an enormous strain upon the poor and diminishing wealth and resources of India. The old saint spoke with great earnestness and asked Ramdas if he agreed with him. Ramdas at once gave his humble and unqualified approval of his dietary upon the evil. Sanyasi was so zealous upon his subject that he was busy circulating notices, getting the pasture on the walls of temples and dharmashalas, writing to newspapers and calling upon all devout people to give up once for all the use of silk, which he described as nothing short of a most sinful luxury. He explained that the wearing of silk was unknown to the ancients of India, since no mention of it could be found anywhere in the Vedas, and its use has not been enjoined by any religious authority. The sannyasi was kind to Ramdas and desired that he should remain in Tirupati for some days. But Ram's command had already come. So next morning, Ramdas left the place for Panchavati, which he reached in the afternoon. He visited Sri Ramachandra Mandir of Panchavati, had the darshan of several sadhus on the banks of Godavari. The following day, walking up to the railway station, he started by the train again, travelling via Manmad and Kurduwadi, came to Pandharpur. Here we remember Kanji Beriwal made a similar appeal. Because somehow this notion had crept into the Brahmin's brain. That whenever they meet a saint, they go in, they consider the silk is free from all that is to be avoided. So all, even for marriage, particularly, you know, it's a big purchase. We all had the privilege of going to a silk factory. Whatever that old man said, we have seen it. We cannot go near the factory. Because after the worms are put in the boiled water, from it it oozes out, you know, and that is taken. So those who have understood, those who have seen, will never use it. I am wondering, 1923, Papa brought this matter in his book to make us know of the wholesome destruction by devout people. You can understand about that, they may not know, you know. But those who are devotees, and who will try to ensure that least himsa is done for their maintenance. We can't say 100%. Least. Whatever is possible, we should try to. Violence in any form, in whatever form it is, whatever is possible, we should try as much as we can. This is not only limited to the silk. Because every time now we know God is testing us. For your welfare, you are trying to protect at the expense of others. So, Kanji Beriwal Those of you who had the privilege of seeing him will know he was wearing khadi, you know. They are trying to get changed. He had made it very clear. At least those who come to meet me, please don't wear. He was not able to stop with that. Because Kanjeevaram is famous for that. So the fear for me. So now we are in the last but one chapter. We will take it up tomorrow. So tomorrow will be the first round, closing of the first round of day after tomorrow. I'm sorry. Day after tomorrow will be the closing of the first round of inquest of God. But don't think that it is going to stop. Just like a cow gathers so many when they are left out in the grazing yard. And when they come back, they settle down, masticate, take something, chew it, assimilate it. Similarly, now we have been grazing all these days. Many, many points were highlighted by Papa and Ram and Papa. And then some we were able to remember. Some we may not. We need some touch. But something are definitely filed knowingly, something are filed unknowingly. So after the first round of reading, we will try to go through in a different way. Not in the way in which we have read. We will try to continue the journey again by the message given by, or the test meted out to Papa by Ram. Up to fourth chapter, we have so many things, you know, to remember. From the fourth chapter onwards, mainly if we look at it, it is nothing but a series of tests meted out to Papa for the final graduation. Because we found a course, an implied, what do you call, course of study. The details of the course of study is in an implied way in the first chapter. So with that background, when we go through, curriculum was there, syllabus was there, and then methodology was there. And what would be conferred, you know? Of course, PhD is there. Now he, the degree part. So he has been taking, Ram has been taking Papa through this. To us, he has already reached it more than PhD. But we found later, through his own writings, that his PhD is something different from what we defined as PhD. So this repetitive pondering over his words will definitely bring out many more unexplored points. And we are now, the trust is slowly building up in our mind that he has done it with a purpose. And that purpose is not merely hearing and going. It's not merely reading and going. The purpose has something to do with our very life journey towards it. With that attitude, we will go through the second type of going through in quest of God. We may not be entirely going through the text again, because we are all now aware. But what are the hints, clues, pointers contained therein, which will help us in our journey, to Him. And here we are placing so many conditions to Ram. unlike Papa, Papa was unconditional. Here we said, you know, all these years you made us to live like this, and you made our equipment to get conditioned by certain things. So you must draft out and chalk out a methodology which is practically possible for us to implement. We cannot follow what we have been hearing, but we could understand the language that when the prayer comes from the bottom of the heart, you will give. So you have to now give us all the limitations which you have imposed on us. We are all in a cage of our own, what do you call it? We have imprisoned ourselves in our own concepts. And we don't know how to get out of it. From the cage we are hearing, but we are still in the cage. And we don't know the technique of getting out of the cage. So now the only way is to pray with you. Highly enable us to come out of the cage. Inside the cage you impose anything, you will definitely do it. But to break the cage, sorry. We have been trying. All these years we have been trying. And we did not know that we have to come out of the cage so far. At least now you have made us understand. We were enjoying the cage. In some way, somebody used to say, even when the cage was open, the bird refused to go out. We remember one episode from Purana. I don't know who was written, but we remember that when Lord Vishnu was requested to take the Varaha Avatar to relieve the hardship imposed by him on other subjects, imposed by Hiranyaksha. So after the work was over, everybody thought Vishnu to be back to Vaikuntha, but he was not seen. Everywhere they searched and searched and searched. Finally Narada said, I know where he is. So he went there. Then he saw a big Varaha. He was there in the form of Varaha. It's a big family there, Varaha family. So when Narada went and told, what a pitiable person. You are Vishnu, you know, you should be in Vaikuntha. You don't know the pressure I mentioned. You have not tasted, that is why you don't know. He gives a big lecture about the blissful state of a Varaha in the Varaha den. Finally, if you remember right, somebody had to use a trident and then relieve him from the cage. Then only he knew what a folly he had committed. So probably this was to remind us that when the Lord is immersed in so many Vyavaharas, it is likely that he may get into the Vyavahara itself. Our plight is like that. Though we all started with remembrance, faith in God, right from childhood already, definitely. We are all, you know, associating ourselves with one Ishtadevata, one Guru, then Puja, Bhajan, Namas, Pilgrim, met so many sadhu, and finally to Anandashram. And there, you know, Papa facilitated every one of us to dwell more and more deeply into the school of thought which she had. In spite of all this, we are still in the Varaha state. So he has to use some other method now to pull us out of the cage of ourselves. So we pray to him, enough is enough. Time is running out. You have to take us out. So with this background, we will again meet on the after tomorrow. Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram Om, Shri Ram. Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram Bhum.
Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram Bhum. Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram Bhum.
Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram Bhum. Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram Bhum.
Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram Bhum. Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai
Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram Om. Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram Om.